Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Classical Mythology, The Basics, Second Edition, by Richard Martin. Narrated by Kyle Snyder. Preface. Classical mythology rapidly draws you into the study of nearly all Western literature, philosophy, art, music, and intellectual history. It does not require advanced knowledge of any one of these, however, to start reading and understanding the tales. This small book attempts to guide the listener to the core elements of ancient Greek and Roman narratives about gods and goddesses, heroes and heroines, while also offering outlines about how the myths shaped culture and were shaped in turn by more than 2,000 years of cultural reception through artistic responses as well as scholarly analysis. This book does not aim to retell or summarize the myths themselves. The five chapters build up the context for where and how myths might have begun, how they were transmitted, what meanings have been found in tales of the world's origin, or figures like Oedipus, Heracles, Antigone, Odysseus, and Medea, and what methods, ancient and modern, have yielded fruit in explaining myths, whether from the standpoint of psychology or politics. As with any interpretive writing about the classics, the best an author can hope for is that the listener will turn with wider interest and curiosity to the primary texts that survive from the distant, ancient world. Richard Martin, San Francisco, August 2015. For this second edition, a new chapter has been added on myth and politics, reflecting the topic's rise in importance over the last few years. Richard Martin, April 2022. 1. Stories that stay. What were ancient myths to the people who invented them? This chapter describes how the Greek word that gives us the English myth evolved from a term meaning speech or utterance into something closer to the modern idea, even in the course of the classical period in Greece, 5th and 4th centuries BC. Myth is put into its broader context of belief and tradition. This in turn will bring us to the growing gap already seen in the classical period between tales like those in Homer and Hesiod and more theoretical ethical thinking. The dissonance led to three major responses by the end of the classical age: outright rejection, rationalization, and allegorization. Each will be examined in turn. Finally, we'll discuss the range of disparate ancient sources from which continuous stories might be woven, or sometimes simply cannot be tied together. Myth as speech. Try this experiment. First, search the internet for the phrase myth of. What comes up? You might find a few references to characters from ancient Greek stories, like the myth of Sisyphus, although in one recent search that summoned up an essay by the 20th century French writer Albert Camus, giving a philosophical spin to the ancient story of the mortal who was condemned to keep rolling a rock up a hill in Hades for eternity. But most occurrences of the phrase will not be about old Greek tales at all. Among 60 million or so results, you will find books, blogs, or articles titled The Myth of Multitasking, The Myth of Innovation, The Myth of American Exceptionalism, The Myth of Welfare and Drug Use, The Myth of Repressed Memory, The Myth of Psychotherapy, and The Myth of the Rational Voter. There's even The Myth of Dry Pet Food Cleaning Dog Teeth. Clearly, the only connection among all these is the habit of calling a myth something that, despite being a widespread and enduring belief or institution, should be considered, at least in somebody's opinion, fake, false, or faulty. Myth, in this meaning, borders on common misconception, or in extreme cases, big lie. Now do a search for mythic. You'll find the adjective attached to heroes, role-playing, adventures and journeys, battles and treasures, creatures, beasts, feats, realms and isles, archetypes, and yes, an occasional pizza shop. In other words, all the items we associate with exciting, exotic, absorbing sagas, whether Tolkien's Lord of the Rings trilogy or the Harry Potter series, can be called mythic in an enthusiastically positive sense. No one employing the word like this implies that these things are misconceptions or lies, although almost everyone admits that they are fictions. What is mythic is simply not in the same category as what people often call a myth. How did this split happen? And what can the schizoid semantics of myth versus mythic tell us about a concept that has been central to human society for millennia? To understand how speakers of English use these terms currently, the internet is a great tool, providing as it does a snapshot of a vast linguistic community. But to get a deeper sense of how we came to speak of myth disparagingly, while appreciating the mythic, one needs to dig into the layers of previous speech habits, through the history of language and philology, the art or science of interpreting and restoring texts, often in older stages of a language. A little of this goes a long way to demonstrating that the basic roots of myth are grounded in story and narrative. At the same time, as some historical investigation can demonstrate, it is this very connection with the essentially social motivations for tale-telling that produces the spectrum of shades, dark and light, negative and positive, we find coloring the concept at the heart of this book, myth. We have to backtrack by two stages to appreciate the complexity of this word, looking first at its development in English, and then going back almost three millennia to archaic Greece. By common consensus, the Oxford English Dictionary serves as the authoritative statement of what our words mean, and have meant as far back as documents in the language survive. The OED defines myth as a traditional story, typically involving supernatural beings or forces, which embodies and provides an explanation, etiology, or justification for something, such as the early history of a society, a religious belief or ritual, or a natural phenomenon. We'll investigate just how well that definition fits classical mythology a bit later in this book. But first, here's a surprise. The earliest occurrence that the editors of the OED can find dates back only to 1830. It seems that writers in the era of Queen Victoria were the first to start spreading the use of the ancient Greek word mythos, modified into English as myth. Alongside its neutral meaning of fanciful story, the negative shadings, lie, falsehood, quickly became part of popular speech. The novelist George Eliot, a.k.a. Mary Ann Evans, in a letter of 1854 reported, "Of course, many silly myths are already afloat about me, in addition to the truth." Here's another surprise. The adjective made its appearance, at least in print, nearly two centuries before the noun, as far as the OED can tell. Theophilus Gale, a theologian, could use it to refer to something that comes from a story or a fable in his 1669 Court of Gentiles, speaking of mythic or fabulous theology, at first broached by the poets. For some reason, the adjective never acquired the negative spin of the noun. Instead, calling something mythical meant as in a myth, not as in a lie. And by the 20th century, mythic had become a way of saying awesome, legendary, or better yet, fabulous. Yet another enthusiastic praise word that started out meaning as in a story, Latin fabula. We might want to dismiss this shiftiness of myth within English as simply a symptom of modern speakers failing to grasp what had been central in a more stable ancient concept. As it turns out, we would be wrong. The Greeks themselves, starting in the classical period, circa 500 to 300 BC, used the word mythos in at least three different meanings: word, fiction, purpose, or thought. What this philological excursion indicates is that, built into the notion of myth from a very early period, there was a basic ambiguity. Is mythos something deeply true or decidedly false? In order to explore that question, we need to push back one further stage into the history of the word, to the earliest continuous Greek texts, the epics of Homer, circa 700 BC. In the more than 27,000 lines of the Iliad and Odyssey, the noun mythos, or verb forms derived from it, occur about 350 times, providing plenty of passages for us to analyze in forming an idea of the core meaning of the concept. Through the conversation of characters, or the practice of the Homeric narrator, and the situations in which the concept arises, we can get more precise indications of meaning. This is the basic job of lexicography, to determine the semantics of a word field, and for much of ancient Greek and Latin, the exacting work is still to be carried out. So what does the word that gives us myth mean in Homeric Greek? Three aspects of the semantic field emerge, at first sight hard to reconcile with one another. Muthos and derivatives refer to commands, speeches of insult, invective, or abuse, recollections and stories based on memory. An example of the first meaning comes when Agamemnon, the commander of the Greek forces besieging Troy, rejects a plea from an aged priest on the enemy side, who has risked his life to ransom his captive daughter. The poet says that the Greek dismissed the old man with a harsh muthos, and then quotes Agamemnon's threatening orders. "Don't let me find you here again. I won't return the girl. Go away so that you get off safely." Iliad, Book 1, lines 25 to 32. The priest feared him and obeyed the muthos. Book 1, line 33. There are many commands designated muthos, most of which are straightforward orders. But given the tone of some speeches of command, like this speech of Agamemnon, it is easier to understand how the word might blend into the next category of meanings, abusive language. When, for example, in the great battle of the Olympians in Book 21 of the Iliad, the war god Ares is about to stab Athena, he addresses her with an insulting little speech.
Book 21, lines 393 to 99.
"You dogfly! Why are you causing the gods to clash with one another?" Recalling that earlier in the battle, Athena had paired up with the Greek hero Diomedes to wound him, Ares goes on to vow vengeance and then makes his thrust at her, but strikes only her magical tasseled shield, the Aegis. She in turn fells him with a boulder thrown at his head. Here too, there is some conceptual overlap. Just as some commanding muthoi, plural of muthos, can be abusive, some abuse muthoi can summon up a version of the past, one that puts the speaker in the best light. That rhetorical strategy is, after all, a well-known practice in trash-talking, ancient and modern. You remind the opposition of all the times that you beat them or tell them how it's now payback time for their past insults. The third semantic area covered by the word that ultimately gives us myth appears to be the most promising for the eventual usage of the word. Recollections and stories built on memories can easily slip into myths if the past that one recalls happens to be the distant time of gods and heroes. For Menelaus, whose errant wife Helen was the immediate cause of the Trojan War, his old war buddy Odysseus is like that, a figure out of the past. Before he was able to guess the identity of the newly arrived Telemachus, his friend's son, who has come to Sparta for news of his long-missing father, Menelaus observed that the young man wept when, "recollecting about Odysseus, I spoke a muthos, muthiomen, about all the things that man endured and suffered for my sake." In other words, Menelaus calls his memories of an old heroic friend the muthos about the man. We can detect here the kernel that will later expand into the usage of the word muthos to mean recollections of long-ago heroic events. What might seem odd is that Menelaus himself, to us a figure from the world of myth, appears to be mythologizing his beloved companion. Now, what are we to make of a wider semantic field in which commands, insults, and memories all interact, like circles in a Venn diagram? This turns out to be the most important, although unfamiliar, feature of the word's use, and it can lead us to understand how the concept developed over the long term. Considering various particular ways in which muthos and its derivative terms are used in Homeric poetry, one can say that the word indicates a speech, often performed in detail and in public, in which the speaker asserts responsibility and power, Agamemnon dismissing an underling, Ares threatening his half-sister Athena. What is more, the ultimate power is control of memory. Being able to articulate the way things were, to set the story straight the way you want, and to adorn it with so much detail that it is totally convincing, such is the power of a muthos. It is a verbal performance, a key aspect to which we'll return, that makes for an authoritative utterance. A muthos, in the earliest Greek narratives to which we have access, is an acting out of authority. But that is precisely why it can be both persuasive and unstable. It is vulnerable to being contested and exposed. The concept of muthos teeters precariously between a truth, the way the speaker wants the story to go, and a lie, the way an addressee, who sees things differently, maybe because she is from a different region or tribe or powerful family, might perceive it. This dynamic, powered by all sorts of specific social interactions, from the very beginning of the word's history kept the concept of myth fluid and open to interpretation. That is part of its power and appeal. It's also why the modern word has inherited a confusing ambiguity as to what the word means. Myth and community traditions. If myth, even in the earliest attestations of the Greek word, involves personal self-assertions, telling tales, and shaping the past in a way that makes the individual speaker look authoritative, why do we still have such stories? Another way of asking this: why did personal verbal performances concerned with some past moment in time become culturally important goods and subsequently get passed down from the first millennium BC to us? Clearly, what counts first is the ability to persuade a wider audience. If the circle of listeners to a mythic tale had good reasons for wanting to believe it, say, it supported a family's claim to some land or to maintaining a status and privileges in the community, persuasion would not be difficult. A number of Greek myths must have started this way. In Athens, one aristocratic family, the Lycomedi, to which the famous 5th century BC politician Themistocles belonged, traced its origin to a hero named Lycos, Wolf, who was reportedly a son of the mythical Athenian king, Pandion. The king's daughters, Procne and Philomela, featured in a gory, well-known myth, which we'll hear more about later. We can imagine that the clan readily passed down stories of their ancient royal origins, as, no doubt, did other kin groups with similarly blue-blooded aspirations in democratic Athens and all over the Greek world. Furthermore, the mythic tradition was probably regularly updated in light of the family's ongoing experiences. Thus, Lycos, in myth, was said to have been banished from Athens by his brother Aegeus, the future father of the great local hero Theseus. He fled overseas to a region, now in southwestern Turkey, that was subsequently called Lycia, in his honor. Themistocles, about 900 years after this mythic ancestor, fell out of favor with the Athenians, despite his key role in their battles against Persia in 480 and 479 BC, and was ostracized by a formal vote used to ban unpopular figures from the city for 10 years. His ultimate place of exile was also in Asia Minor. Did he accidentally retrace the journey of Lycos? Or did the story of Lycos itself become unobtrusively modified to establish a face-saving precedent for Themistocles' fate? In what seems like an anachronistic paradox, Lycos, in myth, goes to Lycia because Themistocles, in actuality, went there. We can follow this tale a bit further to catch sight of another aspect of myth-making dynamics. Why was the mythic hero Lycos important in the first place? Just because the Lycomedi were successful and retrojected their genealogy back to Athenian royalty? That alone provides, as it were, only one anchor in the churning seas of political maneuvering and assertions that marked most ancient Greek life. It took another anchoring device to ensure that Lycos was a viable, prominent ancestral hero. It happened that, not far from the center of Athens, there was a park and exercise ground called the Lucaeon. As with every topographical feature in Greece, behind the name lay a story. This Lucaeon was said to have been named after Lycos, son of Pandion, but at the same time, it was known as the location of a shrine dedicated to Apollo under his frequent cult title, Lycios, literally, of the wolf. Why Apollo had this byname was in turn the subject of several myths. Among them the story that when he performed a year's enforced servitude to the mortal king Admetus, one of his jobs was to keep wolves away from the royal flocks. A separate site-specific tale, recorded in an ancient commentary to a speech by the great orator Demosthenes, claimed that long ago Athens once experienced a dangerous explosion of its wolf population. Apollo's oracle at Delphi told the Athenians to perform a sacrifice at this spot, and the wolves perished from its smell. Though, why the scent of roasting meat would kill rather than attract wolves remains unclear. Was it to bait them? Whatever the reason, the merging of the hero Lycos with the god under his guise of Lycios and their joint connection with the Lucaeon cemented the importance of the hero and his clan in the Athenian imagination. As with so many Greek mythic traditions, there's more to the story that extends into the present day. This open field and its adjacent groves were also associated with Apollo in his role as the god who presides over the transition of young men to manhood. That was probably why a gymnasium complex developed at the site. Socrates, who frequented gathering spots for youths, spent time there. From at least the 6th century BC, the grounds were used as well for political meetings and military exercises, important institutions in the life of Athenian male citizens. The philosopher Plato, 427 to 347 BC, established his school in a grove dedicated to the hero Academos on the other side of the city, which thus became known as the Academy, which is where we get the modern word. So when Aristotle, the pupil of Plato, was searching for a place to found his own school in the 4th century BC, another hero grove, with convenient access to water and a stadium, made sense. He chose the Lycaon, giving the European languages another word for a school, Lyceum, in the modern French educational system, thanks to a classicizing gesture by the Emperor Napoleon in 1802. The public secondary school is called Lycée. Excavations starting in 1996 have uncovered what archaeologists believe are the remains of Aristotle's school, possibly its library or a building for athletics. Located in an upscale city block that is bounded by a military officers' club, the War Museum, and the Athens Music Conservatory, it appears that the area has continued to be associated with at least some of its ancient functions. Power politics and propaganda campaigns made full use of mythic traditions, then as now. The invention of tradition served as a convenient means of connecting people with their past while shading over features that might be less useful in the present. The rapidly evolving society of Athens in the 6th and 5th centuries BC provided a number of examples. Two in particular are worth analyzing a bit further. Cleisthenes, son of Megacles, was a political reformer in Athens during the late 6th century BC. He is credited with making the most important practical changes that enabled true democracy to take hold on the city's political scene. To break the power of wealthy landowning families, the aristocrats who had managed Athens from time immemorial, Cleisthenes, himself an aristocrat but with the backing of the common people, reorganized the population. He signed people of the 139 local districts, demes, that made up the territory around Athens, the region of Attica, to one of 10 newly created tribes. Previously, people from adjacent areas, often kin to one another, had acted together, but Cleisthenes' reform meant that those of one village would be mixed in with people of a different tribe from their neighbors, and, by the same token, any one of the 10 tribes would mix together people of all sorts and degrees, from diverse areas of the region, coast dwellers with mountain men, and so forth. This brilliant move therefore ensured that a whole range of opinion and local issues would be debated whenever the new tribe gathered at its assembly. The tribal unit became the basis for participation in the Athenian democracy, a very new and untried phenomenon at the time. Whenever a citizen competed in local athletics contests, danced and sang in religious choruses, or fought in war, he did so as a member of his tribe. To ease the transition while ensuring the loyalty and engagement of people in the new divisions, Cleisthenes employed myth. Each of the new 10 tribes was named for a legendary Athenian king or hero. These were already familiar figures, so their newness consisted simply in their stories being redirected for a socio-political purpose. They included men like Cecrops, the primeval king who was said to have introduced the pre-Olympian cult of Kronos and Rhea at Athens, Aegeus, famous father of Theseus, and Hippothon, son of Poseidon, a more shadowy figure associated with Eleusis, and thus representing an Athenian claim on that once independent community to its west. Each of the so-called eponymous heroes would be venerated by its tribe, by this means producing the feeling that the given set of citizens were more like an extended family group united by worship. By highlighting the myths of these long-ago figures devoted to the city-state, Cleisthenes also fostered patriotism and pride, a function that national myths still perform in the 21st century. But myth was not just a tool to build democracy. Nearly half a century before Cleisthenes, another Athenian named Pesistratus, circa 600 to 527 BC, used the power of mythical storytelling to cement his claim to one-man rule over the city. He traced his own ancestry, first, to the legendary Neleus, father of the Trojan war hero Nestor, who came from Pylos in the far west of the Peloponnese. In fact, some claim that Pesistratus secretly inserted his claim to the ancestral tie into texts of Homer's Odyssey, which identifies one of Nestor's sons, otherwise unknown to tradition, with exactly this name. Then, just as Athena in the Homeric epics was well known for aiding Greek heroes like Odysseus, Achilles, and Nestor, so too, Pesistratus laid claim to Athena's patronage in a highly theatrical gesture. Exiled once from power, he staged a return to Athenian territory in 556 BC by recruiting a young woman named Phaia, more than 6 feet tall, from a rural village, dressing her as the goddess Athena, in full armor, and placing her in a chariot alongside himself. Heralds running in front of them invited the Athenian to welcome Pesistratus, whom Athena herself honors above all men and is bringing back to her own Acropolis. And they believed. Even Herodotus, the 5th century historian who records this incident, remarks on the crowd's gullibility. Especially strange, he says, since Greeks are more clever than foreigners, and Athenians more than other Greeks. A historian of the 20th century, however, all too aware of how political propaganda with its myths has generated extreme enthusiasm in many places, would be less surprised. Mythologizing oneself through such assertions of continuity with the legendary past or closeness to the divine fascinates the crowd. Then again, the Athenians, with their delight in dramatic productions of all kinds, might have just played along in admiration of the tyrant's own daring ruse and to enjoy the show. One should not get the impression that only Athenians manipulated traditional myth. Every community seems to have had its local heroes who trailed behind them legends of their deeds and skirmishes. With so many stories floating around, there were bound to be contradictions. As we have already learned, a mythos is at base a question of speech and assertion. But different Greek city-states living cheek by jowl inevitably saw their historical traditions differently. This means that their own cherished mythos, as a national truth, would be held up against their neighbor's tale, which then became a myth compared to their own. A laconic sentence from the travel writer Pausanias, 2nd century AD, expresses neatly what must have been the general skepticism resulting from this noisy climate. The Corinthian land is a portion of the Argive, and is named after Corinthos. That Corinthos was a son of Zeus, I have never known anybody say seriously except the majority of the Corinthians. Book 2, Chapter 1, Section 1. Translated, W.H.S. Jones. Yet the traditions of communities, whether cities or families, proved useful, on the larger social stage, if employed in the right way. Indeed, diplomatic relations in the Mediterranean world many times came down to a mutual understanding between Greeks and others, for example, people of places they wished to colonize, that the two parties were kin, related by common descent from some distant ancestor. That required investment by both sides in the veracity of myths. It is said that the indefatigable conqueror Alexander the Great, arriving among a tribal people called the Seboi, in what is now Pakistan, was able to establish friendly relations because they had been settled in their own place by the hero Heracles many centuries before, while Alexander believed that his Macedonian dynasty descended from a hero named Temenos, a son of Heracles. Nearly 2 centuries before Alexander, the Persian king Xerxes had tried to persuade the people of Argos not to go to war with his nation, since he was a descendant of Perses, a son of the famous Perseus, while they inhabited that hero's native place. The Argives were impressed enough by this mythic logic that they made every effort to remain neutral. Myth and belief. So, did the Athenians who lined the road to the Acropolis in 556 BC really believe that the tall girl riding with the ambitious war hero turned politician was really Athena? How do we know, even about friends and family, let alone complete strangers in the present day, what anyone believes? Can we safely talk about the beliefs of an entire population at some distant point in time? The very notion needs interrogation before we enter into the knotty question of whether the Greeks believed their myths. Realistically, we should be speaking of a range of beliefs, as shown by the willingness of individuals or societies to act in certain ways based on particular narratives. We are not talking about facts so much as perceptions through the second-hand experience of being told about something. The reason that people do not usually willingly step out of third-floor windows is because they are personally aware of the fact of gravity, even if they don't have a theory about it or a developed belief in its existence. They just know it operates, like sunrise, snowstorms, snake bites, or sex. But gods or demons or ghosts or angels are different. You might recognize the action of such beings when something good, bad, or unexpected happens, but only because you had already been made aware that other people think such unseen powers exist. And they think that way because they have been told, and so on. To return to the village maiden Athena in the chariot of Pisistratus, the poetry of Homer had already encouraged people to imagine that a goddess could step into a chariot, take the reins, and drive with her hero into battle, as Athena is shown doing in Book 5 of the Iliad. Of course, at some points in the chain of such belief in the supernatural, traditions often posit a figure, mystic, saint, or kinsman of the gods, who had direct, unmediated contact with the world beyond, whether divinities or mysterious powers. In Greek tradition, as we shall discuss in the next chapter, there is no single divine revelation. On the other hand, there are moments of direct contact when a god, usually Zeus, or goddess, such as Dawn, abducts and makes love to a mortal. When these experiences result in offspring, it makes the original divine encounter instantly part of a belief system, especially, as we have already learned, when a powerful clan later traces its origins to such moments. And we cannot discount the power of poetry, which shaped for the Greeks their conception of how the gods and heroes of myth behaved. It is more than a mere literary conceit that both Homer and Hesiod speak of direct contact with the Muses, goddesses of song and the arts. Hesiod claims he met the Muses on a mountainside. We'll examine this in more detail in the next chapter. Homeric epics begin with invocations to the Muse to tell the stories of Achilles and Odysseus, so that the resulting lengthy narratives should be thought of as information coming directly from a timeless divine eyewitness, as the poet puts it when he asks for the Muses' help in recalling each detail of the long catalog of ships. Iliad,
Book 2, lines 485 to 86.
"You are goddesses. You are present. You know all. We, on the other hand, only hear the glorious report, Kleos, and know nothing."
The blindness of Homer, whether or not it was real, is an apt symbol of the murk surrounding the stories of the Trojan War, a fog of possible misinformation that only the divine Muses can cut through. Other moments of epiphany, beyond these paradigmatic poetic contacts, can occur in dreams or on the field of battle, according to Greek lore. This experience is not just a matter of anonymous myth, but finds its way into texts and inscriptions well into the historical period, recorded, most likely, from oral testimonies close to the time of the events. Just before the Battle of Marathon in September, 490 BC, the Athenians who had gathered to repel the Persian invaders sent the long-distance runner, Philippides, to ask the Spartans for aid. He covered 150 miles in 2 days, in vain, since the Spartans agreed to come only after the full moon days later. On his return, Philippides reported that he had seen the god Pan while running through Arcadia. The god of the wild had spoken to him, rebuking the Athenians for not paying him proper attention. The Athenians believed what Philippides said and built a sanctuary for Pan on the slope of the Acropolis, celebrating him each year with a sacrifice and a torch race. It is not impossible that Herodotus, writing about this some 50 years later, had access to people who had heard the runner's story firsthand. The combination of a convincing live account, why would the runner make it up, with the actual Athenian success at Marathon, may well have convinced people that the divine encounter really took place and that the god was on their side. At the same time, as psychologists know, it does not take hallucinations to make people believe what, objectively, never took place. Memory can play tricks, and we can project our own hopes and desires onto the past. All this affects belief. In a way, seeing what a person or group wants to believe is even more instructive than trying to figure out whether something really happened. One story goes that after the Greek victory at Marathon, the Athenians came to honor the legendary Theseus as a semi-divine hero, especially because many of their warriors in the fight thought they saw his apparition, Phasma, fully armed, rushing ahead in front of them against the Persians. Plutarch, who transmits this report in his Life of Theseus, chapter 35, lived more than 500 years after the event. But oral traditions, it has consistently been shown, begin to lose their accuracy after 200 years have elapsed, approximately 5 generations. A 5th century BC wall painting in the Painted Porch, Stoa Poikile, a monument in the marketplace of Athens, depicted Theseus emerging from the earth at the battle, but not leading the charge. Athena and Heracles were also in the picture, and no one was reported as saying that those figures were actually seen on the field. But it may well be that some veterans, around at the time the painting was made, attributed their completely unlikely success over the Persians to some sort of divine intervention. The belief, visualized in the painting in this case, is not so much a literal assertion of an actual viewing, but an effective expression of a more diffuse feeling of supernatural presence one may have got on the spot. The feeling was real, even if it indicated belief in possibilities rather than ascertainable fact. At this point, we need to pause for a moment. It is one thing to speak of mythic narratives that were believed by some part of the population, and another to talk about belief in gods, isn't it? Aren't stories about mysterious apparitions and the deeds of famous ancestors qualitatively different from religious ideas? While we shall examine in more detail in the next chapter the lack of a boundary in Greek culture between myth and religion, it is worth pointing out here a few facts about Greek practices that make such a distinction difficult. Few, if any, rituals or festivals of the gods were without some backstory that explained their origins. In other words, narrative was built into religious activity. That term has to be placed within scare quotes because religio is a Latin word for a very Roman concept, literally binding back, which represents the communication between gods and humans as involving contractual and legal constraint. Greek had no equivalent word for religion, instead referring simply to τα hiera, the holy things, or τα hosia, things set aside for the divine. Greek religious activity cherished no sacred book or set dogma. It had no dedicated priesthood that transmitted doctrine, priests being most often a cross between caretakers of shrines and civic officials. There was no exclusivity. One could believe in any number of gods, Greek and foreign, without being heretical. Popular poetry, built on mythic stories of gods and heroes, came to play a role somewhat like that of the Bible in Judeo-Christian belief, except one was never required to believe them. The range of tradition. A tradition is literally what is handed over, from Latin tradere. When we think of traditions, we imagine some group's agreement on a tale, custom, or set of facts, maybe a family or an intergenerational kin group or village. Traditions can be purely linguistic and highly regional. For instance, in Boston, Massachusetts, where I grew up, the word tonic refers to fizzy beverages like Pepsi, root beer, or ginger ale, to the bemusement of people from regions where these are soda or pop. Tradition can also be simple, practical habits. Another Boston custom, putting out a lawn chair to stake a claim on a street parking space laboriously excavated after a big snowstorm. Popular traditions include festivals, like Carnival in Rio, or the Mummers Parade in Philadelphia. These inspire devotion, loyalty, intensity, and passionate concern each year that the event be done exactly in the right way. Such traditions, whether we call them customs, rituals, or entertainments, are material for anthropologists and folklorists, the two fields from which students of mythology have most to learn. To put it simply, myth and religion are, in ancient Greece, complementary parts of tradition and so tend to blend together. My example of Boston traditions might sound completely trivial, but try telling that to a native Bostonian. In the same way, we cannot readily, from the standpoint of our own allegedly advanced technological culture, pluck out the trivial from the highly serious and Greek mythico-religious tradition. At most, we can try to pin down how widespread or limited a certain feature may have been. A good sense of how local lore, custom, and religious belief all merge with one another comes from reading texts like Plutarch's Greek Questions, 1st to 2nd century AD. Here, the learned antiquarian collects interesting puzzles that must have been topics of conversation at drinking parties or on the street. they might concern words, who is the hypocaustria, she who kindles the fire, in soli, the priestess of Athena, who sacrifices and carries out ceremonies to keep away evil, or beliefs in the power of certain people. Persons credited with averting attacks of epilepsy were known as averters at Argos, and were thought to descend from an ancient Argive hero. Rituals are wrapped up with word lore, but also myth. The Argives use the word enknisma for the special roasted meat made from a fire lit from the hearth of others when a family performs a mourning sacrifice to Apollo. Their own fire is extinguished as being polluted by the death. A clan's name on Ithaca gets explained in terms of a myth about Telemachus, the son of Odysseus, bestowing freedom on the family pig herder, Eumaeus. The taboo against a flute player entering a shrine on Tenedos is said to have arisen because one of these professionals, Molpus, long ago engineered a plot against a Trojan War-era hero, Tennis, who was then exiled to the island. Why does the priest of Heracles on Kos wear women's clothing when he sacrifices? Well, that's a long story. But Plutarch will tell you. Dozens of mythic traditions at Athens have a claim to being serious, widely believed and influential. But one especially stands out, the belief in autochthony. Autochthony, from the Greek compound earth itself, or having the same earth, signifies the notion that a population has primeval ties to the soil in which it lives. A number of ancient peoples, the Arcadians of central Greece, the Sicani of Sicily, the Libyans, thought that they were the first humans arising in their own place. The aristocracy of Thebes and Boeotia traced its roots to the Spartoi, sown men, warriors who sprang from the ground when Cadmus, the city's founder, killed a dragon and sowed its teeth. One cannot get much more literally autochthonous. The Spartans used a variant of the myth to explain their own name. The inhabitants of Aegina, an island near Athens, claimed descent from ants that crawled out of the earth and were metamorphosed into people, thereafter called myrmidons, from Myrmex, ant. But it was the Athenians who seemed to have developed the idea most thoroughly, using myth and religious rites to persuade themselves and others of its truth. According to Athenian mythic history, their early king Erechthonius, sometimes merged with another royal figure, Erechtheus, was born from the soil on the Acropolis. The story went that once the metalworking god Hephaestus attempted to rape Athena, who fought him off. With a piece of wool, she wiped off the semen that had fallen on her thigh and tossed it to the ground. Energy is never lost in Greek myth, as we shall learn in the next chapter. And so Earth, as goddess as well as a substance, produced a baby Erechthonius, either very earthy or wool earth, and presented it to Athena. The virgin goddess put the baby in a basket, along with snakes, entrusting this to three daughters of the ruling Athenian king, Cecrops, named Aglaurus, Pandrosus, and Herse. All three relate to moisture and dew, with the order that they not peer inside. Of course, as with every folktale taboo, the command was disobeyed, and the girls, in terror at what they saw, leapt to their deaths off the high cliffs of the Acropolis. In some versions, Erechthonius himself is half-snake from the waist down, an added monstrosity, but a common motif worldwide in tales of autochthons, as snakes prefer holes in the earth. As with many site-centered myths, a set of rituals and beliefs accompanied this bizarre story. A mysterious annual rite called the Araphoria was tied to religious activities in the service of Athena Polias, of the city, carried out by a few selected Athenian girls, aged 7 to 11. Living on the Acropolis for a year, they assisted in the weaving of the large woolen cloak that draped the statue of the goddess. As their time ended, the priestess of Athena one night would give them some secret objects to convey in a box carried on their heads through a small tunnel leading to a shrine of Aphrodite further down the slope. The girls deposited their burden and came back up the hill with yet another secret package. The rite seems like a symbolic initiatory journey, especially as it so clearly marks out the realm of the virgin Athena as opposed to the sexualized Aphrodite. Their transition from one space to the other, but then back, is like a brief preview of the eventual entry into marriage and family that every Athenian girl might be expected to undergo. Like the symbolism of Erechthonius himself, the truly autochthonous creature whose kingship somehow makes all Athenians, born from Earth, These few girls clearly echo Aglaris and her mythical sisters in a part-for-whole enactment, modeling experiences and behavior for an entire group. This is an effect that all myths, inasmuch as they are representative tales, bring about. In addition, this particular myth involved everyday civic roles as well. Aglaris was said to be the first priestess of Athena, a civic office that continued through antiquity. At her sanctuary on the slope of the Acropolis, those Athenian males who had reached their 18th year and were called Ephebs took an oath to defend Attica. Some generations before his time, according to the 5th century historian Thucydides, aristocratic Athenians wore golden cicadas in their hair in an allusion to their autochthony, insects most conspicuously born from the soil. On a more strategic level, the earth-born nature of the Athenians was used by them as a rhetorical ploy. In the Persian War, the Athenians employed it to claim command, saying they can demonstrate the longest lineage of all, and alone among the Greeks have never changed our place of habitation.
Herodotus, Book 7, Chapter 161, Section 3.
Euripides has one of his self-sacrificing female characters express the same sentiment in a powerful speech from a tragedy no longer completely extant. We are not an immigrant people from elsewhere, but born in our own land. While other cities are founded, as it were, through board game moves, different ones imported from different places. But someone who settles in one city from another is like a bad peg fixed in a piece of wood. He's a citizen in name, but not in reality. Euripides, Erechtheus, from 360, translated C. Collard and M. Crop. Finally, the Athenian myth of autochthony could serve as a model for democracy. After all, if everyone came from the earth, via Erechthonius, they were all kin, all equals. It would take us too far from the analysis of tradition to delve into the fascinating connections that any one myth, such as those we have sketched, can evoke in regard to a god or goddess. But it is worth pointing out once more how the folktale-like stories, say of the three daughters of Kecrops, simultaneously shore up religious belief. Athena and Athens, of course, had been associated as far back as written records go, although it is unclear whether the city was named for the goddess or vice versa. In Athenian mythology, she wins the right to be patroness of the city after a dispute with Poseidon, in which she made the winning offer, an olive tree. The sea god gave brackish water. Athena, as city protectress, must also be a warrior. She uses as weapons the aegis, a snake-trimmed magical goatskin, giving us the phrase, under the aegis of, and the snaky head of the Gorgon, immobilized into the center of her shield. In this role, she nurtures young men, such as the Ephebes. Epic poetry and heroic myths, as we have noted, support that function with constant depictions of the goddess helping heroes, whether Achilles, Odysseus, Perseus, or Jason. As goddess of craft and cunning intelligence, she also oversees the work of women, their weaving and spinning. This, in turn, was featured at her great annual festival, the Panathenaea, that began each new year in Athens. On the 28th day of Hecatombeon, July-August, the woolen robe which the women and young girl assistants had woven for the statue of the goddess was carted to the Acropolis, unfurled on the mast of a wheeled ship. Did every myth, then, have such deep roots in cults, festivals, rituals, and social institutions? Sometimes such connections are difficult to perceive, despite the ongoing work of modern mythologists working with all available evidence. Take, as a final example, the story of another set of young Athenian women mentioned in passing earlier, the daughters of Pandion, a son of Erechthonius, named Procne and Philomela. Procne was given in marriage to Tereus of Thrace, for Athenians, a wild northern region, because he helped her father in a local war. But he became infatuated with her sister, raped her, and cut out her tongue to prevent word getting out. Philomela's only recourse was to weave the story of her sufferings into a robe, which she sent to Procne. Reunited with her sister, Procne then killed it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.